My name is Dan Farrell, and Jordan could not be with us today. And you're listening to It's Not Over with yours truly. And we've been dealing with now the Charismatics and why it would be advantageous for them to become Baptist. Now, I only say that to kind of maybe, you know, tweak your interest a little bit. I understand that becoming a Baptist doesn't necessarily make you a super Christian. And obviously, there's a lot of Baptists who are not what they ought to be. But if it was a good Baptist church that loves God and takes a flat-footed stand for the Word of God and is non-charismatic and just really is a soul-winning church, preaches the grace of God, the whole counsel of God, I think you'd be helped, you see? And it's not just the things that you would learn, it's the things that you would unlearn. And I would like to challenge you to consider going to a Baptist church. Now, most of your churches, you don't have church on Sunday night. So your old-fashioned Baptist churches that are really excited about the Bible, they'll have services on Sunday night. And maybe what I ought to do sometime is do a program on what to look for in the kind of Baptist church that you're looking for. And it would only be my opinion, but I think there'd be a little bit of wisdom, you know, peppered and salted in that talk, and maybe it'd help you, right? But if you go to Assembly God, Church of God, Pentecostal, a lot of the things, like for instance, let me give you an example. You think Baptists are against people shouting amen. We're not. You think Baptists are against people raising their hands saying praise the Lord. No. I think if it's in your heart, right, it's got to be sincere. And if it's in your heart to say praise the Lord, then do it. It's fine. You know, we're not going to be legalistic about it. But when you start doing this, hallelujah, Jesus, and you start doing that kind of stuff. Now, here's the problem with that. Okay, you ready for this? First of all, can you put your hands down? I'm trying to watch the preacher. I'm trying to listen to the preacher. The focus ought to be on the Word of God, not you, man. Okay? You're just drawing attention to yourself. You say, well, that's not what I don't care what you're trying to do. That's what you're doing. You're standing up and, you know, you're doing all these gyrations and genuflex and, you know, I don't know what you think you're doing. The Bible says that let all things be done decently in order. 1 Corinthians 14. So calm down a little bit. Now, in some of your non-charismatic churches, you do have people that are a little bit bizarre. You know, they run the bases and they run around and scream and hallelujah. Imagine if you get 55 people doing that. Man, it's pandemonium. And do you realize people that are lost and hurting, and they come to a church service like that and they see that foolishness, you know what they think? They think you're a nut. That's what they think you are. Now, they probably think I'm a nut too, by the way I preach and teach. Okay, you can't help some of it. But really, you got to have these outlandish emotional outbursts. Where do you see that in Scripture? In fact, Paul says, how can a man say amen unless if the trumpet not give a certain sound and so on? Now, Paul didn't say, how can a guy say, hallelujah, Jesus, praise God, bring home the mail. Blah, 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 blah. I mean, Paul didn't even use that as an illustration or an example. So I believe that many of you are going to churches that are highly emotional and they stir up. And again, I get it. I mean, when you go to a baseball game, you want the fireworks and you want people jumping up and down screaming when the home run is hit. But that's the problem. You see, a church it's not a baseball stadium. A church is not a rock concert. A church is not a Las Vegas vaudeville show. A New Testament church is not supposed to be a hockey game, you know? Some of you live in the flesh and you think your church ought to be fleshy. When you judge things, you always judge things in a carnal way. And that's sad, you see? And I think you need to get in a good church, but I also think you need to have a transformation in the way you think, because you're always going to be up and down, in and out with this Christianity that's truly based on emotionalism, and it's not Bible-based. Another thing, too, about a scriptural church, the emphasis is on Jesus Christ, not the Holy Spirit. You go to a church where all the emphasis is on the Holy Spirit, that's not of the Holy Ghost. Holy Spirit, John 14, John 15, John 16, says that the job and the ministry of the Holy Spirit is to draw people into truth and to point them to Christ. You see, the Holy Spirit does not attract attention to himself. So you go to a church where all the emphasis is on the Holy Spirit, that ministry is not of the Holy Spirit. But see, you'd have to read the Bible to understand that. Now, let's talk a little bit about healing And today we have the special oils, the prayer cards. Put your hand on the radio, get a prayer cloth, a handkerchief, and so on. And, you know, a lot of these fake healers have made lots of money off of naive people. Okay, that's sad, really sad. These guys have become millionaires through this. And what makes things difficult for the naive sign seeker is that many charismatic leaders know just enough proof texts in the Bible to thwart you and deceive you. Because, see, you don't study the scripture. The Bible says, study to show thyself approved, a workman that needeth not to be ashamed, rightly dividing the word of truth. And so you don't do that. Now, what does the Bible say about healings? In the Bible, there are three areas of irrefutable miracles: healings, raising the dead, casting out devils, visible evidences of that, and miracles. For instance, the loaves and the fishes walking on the sea, still in the storm. Now, the scriptures are full of examples when Jesus Christ performed these miracles by divine power, though the apostles only were used in the first two categories, okay? Like, for instance, we don't see the Holy Spirit, we don't see apostles feeding the 5,000. We don't see apostles walking on water, okay? But we do see the apostles in the first two areas. The Lord Jesus healed with a touch or a word. The centurion's servant was miles away. Jesus spoke the word, and the guy was healed. The woman with the issue of blood touched only the hem of his garment, Mark 5:25, and she was healed. And Luke 6:19, and the whole multitude sought to touch him, for they went virtue out of him, and he healed them all. Now, how could you be healed if you can't touch Jesus? Well, it's by faith. I believe in divine healing. I don't believe in divine healers. If I was the divine healer, I wouldn't be on this radio program. I'd be at Children's Hospital in Cincinnati, in Dayton, in Westchester. I'd be going to St. Elizabeth, the fifth floor. I'd be going to various hospitals like the intensive ICU and so on. I would be emptying these places. If I was a faith healer and I had the power to heal, you wouldn't have to come to a circus tent with the organ music playing, and you wouldn't have to put in a love offering to get me to lay hands on you to heal you. You understand? Those two-bit, four-flushing fakers are fooling you, and I get it. Your little girl has got cancer, and the doctors don't give her a chance to live. I understand. Look, I'm not going to condemn you. You're going to take her to the big circus tent so the fake healer can lay hands. Okay, I get it. You're desperate, and you love your little girl. I don't really get on you, but that dude, are you kidding me, man? And then if your little girl's not healed, it's because you have a lack of faith, or your little girl has a lack of faith. In fact, I got in a discussion one time with a woman. I used to pastor in Northern Kentucky, and I was out door knocking one time, and I came across this woman, and I said, hey, my name is Dan Farrell, and I'm from such church. And she goes, ah, praise God, hallelujah, help, praise God, I'm full of the Holy Ghost, and I speak with tongues and cloven fire and so on. I said, okay, well, nice to meet you. And I said, so you're a healer. She goes, praise God, hallelujah, Jesus, you bet your bottom, honey, you know. And I said, okay, well, I just came from St. Elizabeth, the fifth floor, and there's a little girl there, and she's got like third-degree burns. Man, it's horrible. She may die. They had to strap her hands down because she's peeling the skin off of her in shock. I said, could you, I'm just a dumb Baptist preacher. Could you go with me and lay hands on her and heal her? And she's like, well, honey, I just don't know if she's got the faith. Huh. Well, you see, that little girl's hurting. I mean, really hurting. The parents are just devastated. She's got burns all over her body. I said, look, you tell that girl, I don't know, it wouldn't matter. Just tell her that if she'll believe in Jesus, she'll believe. I mean, the girl's desperate. She goes, well, I just don't know if the Holy Spirit's leading me to do that. I said, well, look, again, I'm a Baptist preacher, okay? I feel like the Holy Spirit's leading me wherever there's a need, and he providentially brings it to my attention. My car's right down the street. I'll even provide a ride. I'll take you right there, and you can heal this little girl. She goes, well, I just don't know if she has faith. By that time, I'd had it with this goofy woman. And so I looked at her. I said, you know what you are? You're a two-bit faker. You're a hypocrite, and you're a liar. You know what you are. And she goes, well, you're an SOB, and she slammed the door in my face. Now, I know that's a little rough for some of you. But you see, I don't have any patience for people like that. I don't. I think you're a snake in the grass. Man, I don't have any patience with you. And you say, well, I just don't think you ought to say, I don't care what you think. You say, well, you shouldn't judge. Yeah, I should. Bible says when you judge, judge a righteous judgment. And I did. That woman's full of the devil. You got it? That's right. And a lot of these religious quacks are full of the devil. And some of you are so naive, and you're almost like a religious political correct person. You know, you're afraid to go ahead and call a spade a spade. If they don't speak according to this word, it's because there's no light in them. Now, I'm not talking about little minor things, you see, because I realize I can be wrong on some things. I understand that, and you can be wrong on some things. But that kind of thing right there, yeah, that has ruined the faith of many. That has destroyed families, that thing right there. And some of you fall for it. And so we could go on and on how Jesus immediately healed, but that's something too that I want to bring to your attention. When Christ healed, it wasn't a three-week process. When Jesus Christ healed the woman with the issue of blood, immediate. The 10 lepers, when he healed them, immediate. The lame man at Bethesda, immediate. The blind man that was born blind, he washed and came seeing. I'm telling you, these healings were amazing. Jesus healed totally. There was no recuperating. There was no relapse. When Jesus healed him, the deaf could hear, and it wasn't just a little bit. And the blind could see, and it wasn't a cloudy vision. The lame could walk and leap. They didn't limp. And the lepers were whole, not just a little better. Jesus healed everyone that he touched because he had the power. Whether it was an organic disease, a leper, a withered hand, a body sore that was running, deaf, blindness, raising the dead, replacing an ear, cured a lunatic, a palsy, a headache, a backache, a heart murmur, lazy liver, kidney stones, it didn't matter. The Lord Jesus Christ had the power to heal, and he raised the dead. Now, the apostles could do the same thing because they had the gifts of the apostles, you see. But the purposes of these miracles were what? To draw attention to the Word of God. You see, it was to grab the attention of the Jews and others that this new movement, this new completed Bible, is the holy Word of God. It wasn't just so that this guy would no longer limp or this person would no longer be bedfast. It was to draw attention so that the crowd that witnessed the miracle, see, would understand that the gospel is real, that God is not messing around, and that the Bible is true. And so what it does, it gives credence to the messenger. Therefore, it gives great power to the message. Does that make sense? But today, the apostles are gone. You see? And we still have divine healing, but sometimes God heals, sometimes he doesn't. We don't have divine healers. We'll talk a little bit more about this next time. You've been listening to It's Not Over. My name is Dan Farrell, and Morningstar Baptist Church is so gracious to put this program on. We also have a college called Antioch Baptist Seminary that starts August 24th. And if you're interested in the level of boot camp, officers training, or special forces, we have new programs designed to streamline an education that'll make you a better Christian, a better teacher, a better preacher. And so you think about that. Contact us at Antioch Baptist College. .net. We've changed the name to Antioch Baptist Seminary. The other thing, too, that we want to make you aware of, we're so excited about what the Lord is doing with our ministry. Delta Force, PreachTheStreets.com. Check that out. Check out the movie called Delta Force / the movie. And that'll be on YouTube. You'll see it on people's Facebook. You'll really love that hour-length movie. And I appreciate you listening. Now, I understand that you're charismatic. And, you know, you don't appreciate a Baptist being so forthright. But let me say this. You ought to appreciate me. And here's why. Many Baptists believe just like I do. But they're afraid to speak this plainly is going to invite too much criticism. It's going to invite criticism. That's true. It's very true. But the reason why I'm speaking like this is because I think God could touch some of your hearts, and because I do care about you. I love charismatics. If you're saved, you're a true believer in Jesus Christ, you're washed in the blood, you're a born-again child of God, you're my brother. But I think you could be a better soldier of the cross if you become a Baptist and go to a Baptist church, like I said, on Sunday night. Would you think about it? Pray about it. God bless you. I'll be with you again next time.